In lecture number 5, we'll be looking at different detection methods. So basically here I will go through the many different detection methods, and then later on I will go more in depth with the network-based detection. So botnet mitigation is really challenging because it can be quite difficult to find the command and control servers. And often these, as we discussed before, operate behind different layers of proxies, and they are in different countries. So that's quite challenging. The different approaches I will go through in this lecture, in my opinion, I would say it's needed to combine them. So we cannot say that one way is going to solve all our problems with botnets and malware. What is important to keep in mind, we discussed the businesses in the introductory part, is that the programmers behind are highly skilled people with access to a large amount of resources, and that they put a lot of efforts into not being detected. So we have to do with an enemy who really wants to remain stealth. And so that's one challenge we have. And another challenge we have is that we want to avoid the false positives. So we really need a high detection accuracy, because if we detect, let's say, 1,000 machines as infected, but only one of them is it in reality, then our system is basically useless. So we have to be able to say very precisely which machines are infected and not only which are potentially infected. Let's go to the overview of the detection approaches. So the first I will mention is what I will call non-network-based detection, so a detection which is working on the individual host. So that could be, for example, antivirus programs, which can inspect software and see what is going on the individual host. This can be quite efficient if it is updated and if it is correctly used by the users. And there are different problems with them, such as they usually are not good in zero-day detection. So they can only deal with known threats. So if there is a threat that they have not seen before and which is not included in the program yet, then it's very hard to detect it. Also, it suffers from what is called social engineering. So if the human people is overruling it, and if you allow installing a piece of software, even if you receive a warning against it, well, then it doesn't really work that efficiently. And what we see often is that people tend to be easy to manipulate. So whenever you get a warning, you need to update flash players. Quite a lot of people would actually go ahead and do it. Also, in order to be really efficient, it needs to work not only on the PC platform, but it needs to be installed on all network devices. And with Internet of Things coming up, with people being connected to the internet on the phones, on iPads, tablets, computers, all different kind of devices on the internet, then it's increasingly difficult to ensure that you have updated antivirus on all your devices. Then there are the network-based methods, which include anomaly-based, signature-based, and methods based on statistical traffic analysis. So I will just briefly mention these different ones. So there is anomaly detection, which is basically that if you can see that there is a very unusual behavior that could be triggered by a high network latency, or that you see a lot of traffic or a big increase in the amount of traffic or traffic on unusual ports, then you say, this looks really is suspicious because it's considerably different from normal network traffic. When we're talking about botnets, this is more likely to occur in the last phase where you actually have some malicious activities going on. So a DDoS attack would trigger this because it's a lot of traffic which looks very specifically and which is very different from your usual traffic. Or it could be the spam because you have a lot of emails sent by mail servers which you usually wouldn't be using. And actually, to some extent, fast logs can also be detected in this way if you are contacting a DNS server which is different from a DNS server that would usually be used within that particular network. I know that, for example, in Aalborg University, if we are using DNS servers which are not the DNS servers of the university, then we get a call from the IT asking what is going on. Then moving on to the next slide, we have signature-based detection, which is really works by that you look into the content of the of all the packets. So you need to look into the payload or into the patterns of the packets, and then look for signatures related to specific malwares or specific botnets. It's a hard task to do, and especially it's hard if the content is encrypted, or if you're looking for something which is not yet known. So it suffers from some of the same shortcomings as the host-based. But of course, since it's working in the network, you don't have to install it on all different kind of devices, and it's easier to ensure that it's updated, especially if you are in a professional organization. Then the approach that I would go more into depth with, and that we are working more with in Aalborg University, is to try to distinguish benign traffic from botnet traffic and malicious traffic by using statistical analysis on the network traffic, and we're using machine learning algorithms to do so. So this can really be applied in all places of the network, as long as all the relevant data is passing through this point. So even large amount of data, we try to look into the network traffic and see, can we see that there is something suspicious here? So what we look at is statistical information about the flows, in the network flows, such as the packet lengths, the flow length, the number of incoming packets, number of outgoing packets, port numbers, which countries we're communicating with, or even which continents we're communicating with. But of course, this works only if there is actually a difference. So if you want to see the difference between the malicious and non-malicious activities, we can only do so if there is a difference between them. And this is something which we will also cover in the next videos. I would also say that what we are doing and what I find to be most interesting is to focus on the command and control traffic, because then again we can do something before something really malicious is really going on and some harmful activities are being carried out. So for now, please take quiz 11 and see you soon for the next video.